Following on from my recent video about building an old PC, I said that I'm finding it harder and harder to recommend getting into the hobby of building old computers just because the prices are getting out of control. It's not like I can't afford it, but really just in the face of cost of living increases and generally people having less money for their hobbies, I just find it difficult to, in good conscience, sit here in my ivory YouTube tower acting like this is a hobby that everybody can afford. I am passionate about old computers, and I would love for anybody who watches one of my videos to get stoked about old computers too. What gets me stoked is lowering the barriers for entry for these hobbies, and this is where emulation comes into play. The first thing to talk about, I suppose, the elephant in the room is emulation legal? My immediate answer really is, who cares? We're talking about products, we're talking about things that you just cannot buy anymore. All of the old operating systems are hosted up on WinWorld PC. I don't really care where you get your games from. I'll leave it up to you, but ultimately,
emulation has never actually been proven to be legal, and it's always morally correct to pirate things.
Right, we've got that out of the way. So now let's get on to the actual purpose of this video, is to talk about how you can emulate old systems and play old games on your new computer. There's three main ways of going about this, really, and I'll be going over these with increased detail. The first one is ScummVM. You might have heard of this. All the old LucasArts games ran in an engine called Scum. That stands for the Script Creation Utility for Maniac Mansion. You didn't need to know that, I'm just showing off. A lot of the old DOS-based adventure games started to get difficulty running on newer machines, so about 20 years ago, a team of extremely cool people released ScummVM for free. It's actually emulating a machine that the game is then running in, so it is kind of emulating a PC. All you really need to know about it is it has a front-end graphical user interface. You can import games into it like some kind of media player, and you can just run them from that. There's about 250 games now that are supported by it. It's super lightweight, so you can actually run it on a phone. You don't even need to run it on a computer. It's a really good way for getting into a lot of these old adventure games, but that's the limit. It doesn't do anything outside of that. It doesn't have as many quality of life improvements as the next two, but it was worth mentioning. Next up is DOSBox. If you've tried to run old PC games from the early 90s, the chances are you've heard of and have probably tried to run DOSBox. I'm just going to say there's probably a pretty good likelihood that you tried it, had no idea what was going on, and ran away in the opposite direction. And completely honest with you, fair play. Messing around with DOSBox is very much like messing around with an actual DOS computer from about 1992. There's a lot of typing into the command line, there's all these commands that you need to remember. There is a lot to it, but I think the trick to DOSBox is just taking your time, reading the documentation, and if you get stuck wanting to do something specific, then just Google it, because there are smart people out there who've already done all the hard work. I do think it's a bit of a tinkerer's platform, but then again, I think DOS is also a bit of a tinkerer's platform, and it was back in the day. I quite like the feeling that I get when I actually get something running properly, so your mileage may vary, but I like it. I've got DOSBox installed here, and I've just got a bunch of downloaded DOS games installed here. This is my setup file here, and you can see that I've got a batch file that sets my root directory to that DOS games directory. So when I open DOSBox, it runs that little batch and it automatically opens my command line to that games directory. So then I can just use dir to have a look at what's in there, and then I can use cd to move into those folders. Those are probably the two most basic DOS commands you need, and then you just type in the name of the thing you want to run, and Bob's your uncle. You can tweak your DOSBox settings. There are certain games that are a bit finicky and will require a few things being changed. One of the most common ones is changing the CPU cycles for games like Wing Commander that would just run a million miles an hour. A lot of smart people create different config files set up specifically for individual games. Hey, if that's what you want to do, then you go for it. One thing that I am particularly proud of is I've got really good MIDI sound coming out of DOSBox. So I've done this by installing a MIDI device emulator. There's a lot to go in, and I'm not really going to go into it here, but essentially a MIDI device emulator takes the MIDI output of DOSBox and then puts it into an emulated MIDI device. The one that I used is called CoolSoft VirtualMIDISynth. in DOSBox, just like in DOS, you can ask it for a list of your MIDI devices so you can check the IDs match. You can then install different MIDI sound fonts for your virtual MIDI device. You can download those from the internet. I've got some links in the description. My favorites personally are Weeds GM3 and Fluid R3 GM. Admittedly, this is a bit involved. You don't actually need to do this because DOSBox will just send out MIDI music through the GM wavetable, but listen to this. If this is already feeling like it's a bit much, I can appreciate that. I will say, if you happen to have bought an 80s or a 90s PC game from Steam or from GOG, the chances are that what you've actually bought is the original DOS game and a tweaked version of DOSBox that's been included in the installation. So when you run the game, you're actually running DOSBox. If you've got 20 of these games on your computer, there's a chance you've actually got 20 different setups of DOSBox installed on your computer. I reckon a good way to learn would be going into those folders, opening up those individual DOSBox configs, and just having a look at how they're set up. Maybe change a few things in there to see if you can make a difference in the game. Because the cool thing is, if you mess it up, you can just delete the whole thing and reinstall it from Steam. So I think that might be a pretty solid way to get to grips with DOSBox. Finally, if you are looking to emulate a full Windows PC inside your existing PC, then you're far better off using PCem. PCem is a massive bit of software. It is capable of emulating a bajillion different computers, going all the way back to those really old XT and Tandy 8-bit computers of the 1980s, all the way through to more modern Super Socket 7 or Slot 1 PCs of the late 1990s. The cool thing about PCem is you kind of get to build your PC because you get to select all your components that you want to emulate. Emulating older PCs is much easier, as you can probably imagine, and you are going to need a pretty beefy PC if you want to accurately emulate a more modern machine like a Pentium 2. To show you how it works, I'm going to take you through the process of me setting up a brand new PC. Once you've installed PCem, get it running and hit new. I'm going to build for you today a Windows 95 Pentium 1 PC. So, under motherboard, we're going to select the Shuttle Hot. I don't know why it's called that. It's an award motherboard. Next, we're going to choose which CPU we're going to emulate. I am personally going to choose the Pentium 166MMX. For graphics, there's a lot of good stuff to choose from here. I have had success emulating the S3 Trio and the Diamond Stealth, but today I'm going to use the S3 Verge. And of course, we will be adding a Voodoo Graphics 3D card. We're going to use a Voodoo 2, and here are your settings for that. And then we're just going to have a basic Sound Blaster 16 for sound. The CD and the floppy drives are automatically added by the emulator, so next we're going to set up the virtual hard drive. This will set up a page file on your PC, so the emulator will treat that file like its own hard drive. Just of note, once it's created, it will take up the same amount of space no matter how much stuff you've installed, because it's always going to reserve that volume size. Just for the sake of neatness, I created a new folder on my PC for that file to go into, and I gave it a relatively sensible name. When creating your virtual hard drive, you can choose to either create cylinders or you can just set the actual memory size. The maximum supported number of cylinders is 16383, which equates to an 8GB hard drive, which is frankly going to be more than plenty for like a Windows 95 PC. Perfect. Now, once that's all set up, we've got all of our components in place and we can actually boot our emulated PC to see if what we did is going to work properly. All right. There we go, there's the emulated motherboard BIOS, perfect. And then that prompt at the bottom is complaining that there's nothing on the hard disk drive and that there's no boot floppy present, which is what we want to see at this stage, so that's great. We can solve that right now. So Control and End frees up your mouse so that you can use it outside of the emulator. And then we're going to go up here, going to go to disk, and then we're going to load a floppy image. Think of that basically just like a ROM, but it's a ROM of all the files on a floppy disk. I've got the Windows 95 boot disk here, which I got from WinWorld PC. The boot disk basically contains a tiny version of DOS, which is going to let us partition and set up our hard drive. It sounds technical, but don't worry, I've got you. Now we're here, we're going to type fdisk. Yep. One. Yep, one. Yep, 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 yep. Okay, that was easy. That was us creating the primary disk partition. So now you can tell everyone that you've created your very own primary disk partition. So, you know, that's pretty good. Now we're just going to reset the PC. Don't forget, free your mouse with Control and End. And once we're back here again, we're going to type format C. 1, 2, miss a few, 99, 100, and she's done. So now what we've got is we have a blank hard disk drive in our computer. Now we have that, we can now access the CD-ROM and we can get the PC ready to install a permanent operating system. In this instance, I'm going to use Windows 95. Again, I got the ISO from WinWorld. Free the mouse, load the ISO, switch to your D drive. Do you remember your DOS shortcuts from earlier? Yeah, nice one, right? Yeah, now we're gonna dir and set up. There you go, see, that's just what we wanted. Windows is now setting up. That was pretty straightforward, I think. Once that's done, there are some final steps that we need to do before we can start playing games. We've told the emulator that our PC has these sound and these graphics cards, and much like a real PC, we now need to install the drivers in order to get them working properly. So go into your graphics properties. We can see here Windows is running the basic graphics adapter, but we want to install the drivers for that S3 card. That's not a problem. See, I've got the drivers here. I load up the ISO, bada boom, bada bing, jobs are good. For the Voodoo 2, the process is similar. You can see here in Program Manager, Windows is saying that it can see a PCI device, but it doesn't know what that is. That's okay. We can extract the Voodoo 2 drivers. Thank you very much to Phil's Computer Lab. And you can see here that they're going to see Windows temp. They're not actually installing, they're just extracting to that location on our hard drive. If you check back, you can see that device still isn't recognized. But now what you need to do is double click and then click update the driver, and Windows will ask you where that driver is. And you know, because it's in C, Windows temp. It might ask for the official CD, but that's okay. You can go, yeah, no worries, bud. C, Windows temp. Bish, bash, bosh, and we're all done. Quickly restart your PC and you're now all set up for some games. The Sound Blaster is included in Windows, so that doesn't need to be installed. You're all ready to go. I can actually show you here some of the PC games that I've been running for stuff on the channel recently. So here's a bit of Stephen King's F13. Here's a little bit of Independence Day. I also installed some Need for Speed, so you can see some kind of speedier 3D games. All working absolutely fine, like no trouble whatsoever. If you are running games and you're experiencing some audio stuttering, there's a really good chance that what's happening is your own CPU is topping out, trying to emulate the virtual CPU. The easiest way that you can resolve this is come back out of the emulator, going back into the settings from the beginning and just dropping down the CPU that you're trying to emulate. That solved my issues, so that's the biggest bit of advice I can give you. So there you have it. This video was never really intended to be about getting old games running on your new PC, but perhaps trying to recreate the sensation of tinkering with old computers using emulation. Hopefully, if you've been wondering recently, oh, I wonder if you can emulate PCs, you found this video useful and maybe that you've got a little more confidence now going into the world of PCs and into emulation. Just to reiterate, this video came about because of my most recent retro PC build. Old stuff is getting really expensive now, and I'm finding it hard to recommend it. My hope is that people who want to get into old PCs and into old PC games, that emulating a Windows 95 system can give you enough of that experience that you don't have to invest a shitload of money in buying an old computer. Thanks very much for watching this one. As you can probably tell, this is something that I take quite seriously. I never really wanted to have a channel where I talk about things that are expensive or out of reach for people, and so I really hope that this is going to be useful to somebody out there. If nothing else, I hope you enjoy just looking at some rad old computer games. And if you like this stuff, then please check out some previous uploads. I've got a bunch of old computer stuff on the channel, and there's always new stuff coming out all the time. If you're interested in technology and popular culture from the turn of the millennium, then that's what we do here on Stoked. So hit that subscribe button, and I'll see you in a future video. All right then. Ta-da.